brand.
History has created a mythical Africa. Nature's greatest gift to man, land of savage beauty, a dark continent awaiting exploration, an endless playground to the big game hunter. The world hangs on to this romantic image of Africa. In reality, Africa is a continent in peril. Man the hunter has been part of the African landscape for millions of years. The age of traditional hunting is ending. Now, men hunt with weapons against which wildlife has no defense. No other large wild animal in the world is being wiped out at the rate of Africa's black rhino. Poachers are crossing foreign borders, risking their lives to kill the last rhinos. Men are now killing men to save another animal. Only 20 years ago, 65,000 black rhinos roamed the African continent. Poachers have killed so many that today less than 2,500 survive. If this rate of slaughter continues, the black rhino will not survive this decade. The rhino is being pursued by two forces, one to kill it, one to save it. This rifle is loaded with an anesthetic dart, not bullets. Zimbabwe was once the stronghold for the black rhino. Here, for decades, the National Parks and Wildlife Service has been waging war against poachers who supply horn to an illegal market. The rhino rescue is being led by National Parks bush vet, Dr. Michael Koch.
I mean, we have a drought in this country at the moment that is devastating the southeast. People are dying, I mean, animals are dying, both domestic and wildlife. There's no food available. But this is the story of Africa. I mean, if you go from the tip of Africa to the top, there's problems, there's wars, there's rioting, there's people starving, there's droughts. Wildlife hasn't got a hope in the face of that sort of complexity.
Out of desperation, rhinos are being evacuated from the wilds of Zimbabwe. to be flown to Australia. Here and in other centres throughout the world, they will be bred up with the hope that one day, when the rhino's homeland is safe, their progeny will be returned from exile. This is one last supreme effort to get black rhinos out of peril by getting them out of Africa. The rhinos are taken to enclosures, or bomas as they're called in Africa. Here, under guard, they'll be given time to settle down to captivity before being flown to Australia.
Before the animals going to Australia, we've done what we call tipping, which means we take away the sharpness of the horn, make it blunt, and it takes them a lot longer to do damage.
While still unconscious, the animals are numbered, then given a drug that reverses the effects of the anaesthetic.
Well, we have an agreement between the Zimbabwean government and the Department of National Parks and the International Black Rhino Foundation to provide 40 black rhino to support captive breeding programs in Australia and North America.
The rhino's aggression compensates for their short-sightedness. In a drugged state, even this mother and son will fight.
You don't realize how strong they are until you actually see them break down a crate or fight. They continue to bash that nasal bone and they can actually just collapse it. That's a real risk factor.
Today in Zimbabwe, less than 200 black rhinos survive in the wild.
It was very depressing to fly and because the habitat is so good for rhino. They should have been popping out of the bushes like rabbits, but they've just been hammered by poachers.
Zimbabwe, a landlocked nation, is now under siege. War-torn Mozambique to the east and Zambia to the north have exterminated their black rhino. Poachers from these countries now penetrate Zimbabwe, particularly Chetty Wilderness Area, on the shores of Lake Kariba. Chetty in the mighty Zambezi Valley is the front line for poacher attacks from neighboring Zambia. Decade ago, rhinos were here in their hundreds. Now, only 16 remain. Chetty is within sight of Zambia. There are too few national park scouts to patrol a shoreline stretching over 1,000 kilometres. The scouts are led by Chetty's National Parks warden, Norman English, known to his men as Stormin' Norman. Born and bred in the bush, Norman English knows it like an animal. His mission is to kill poachers who kill rhinos.
This is number 104 now, I think. Yeah, 104. Yeah. Since what, 85?
30% of all carcasses we never locate.
How many cases we not tatir?
16 rhino are left in the area now, total, that we know of.
At the present rate of slaughter, all of Chetty's rhinos will be dead within a year.
They use a lot of ammunition when they do it. It's fully automatic and they just spray it. In the chest, the head, starting at the front, and they just rake the whole thing. They are pushing the gangs in flat out.
They pack automatic rifles into suitcases and board Zimbabwe-bound trains. Once across the Zambezi, they simply disappear into the bush.
We've just got information 2 days ago that two gangs, one of four and one of five, have coming in from our eastern area here, and they will be coming in looking for these remaining rhino around here almost definitely. They will be coming in. They're trying to get in before we get a hold of those rhino.
Between national parks and poachers, it has become a race for the last of the Chetty rhinos.
Mike, are you there? Over.
Go, Andy. Just watch. Yeah, I've got Andy. I'm trying to load darts, so just talk to Shelton.
The narcotic used to knock out rhinos is M99.
Whereabouts, Shelton? Where's she going to cross? Closer.
Just one prick on the finger will kill a man in seconds.
Ask him whether I should run down the road rather than going on the truck.
Confirm you've loaded the dart?
Yes, confirmative. Affirmative. Okay. Okay, let's go. Let's go. What do you want me to do, Andy?
Confirm you're not visual, Evan.
I am. No, not visual.
Yeah, go back.
He's coming in from your left. Only about 150 metres away now. Travelling fast. Go forward about 50 metres. Go forward. Over.
The rhino travels a long way from the road before the narcotic takes effect. A track has to be cut through the bush as fast as possible, because the longer an animal is unconscious, the greater the risk of complications.
The biggest risk to the rhino capture is probably from trauma. We've got the capture methodology down to a fine art, I think. With black rhino, we've, in 150 rhino that I've been involved in, we've never lost one at capture. Mortalities occur later on. That's our problem.
The scouts were tracking it, and there was a calf, and you can tell that she's got a lot of milk. But it's probably a young calf because, you know, she's really swollen. These cows are very vulnerable to predators in the first few days of life.
While the cow is loaded onto the truck to go to the boners, the best trackers set off in search of the calf. Beaten by the failing light, trackers will stay in the area overnight to deter predators.
Yeah, it could be lucky, but I had some lion that direction last night, but I think I might survive. With the disturbance the lions will have from these cows that are in the area.
At first light, the scouts continue the search. They follow tracks and signs of the calf, known as spoor. It survived the night, but has been eating twigs and leaves, food unfit for an unweaned calf. There is no time to lose. The baby must be found. Search is made, Norman English and his scouts track on the ground.
I just saw what I'm sure was a baby rhino. I'm sure I saw the baby rhino. I'm going back for another look.
Sure you didn't see a warthog, over? Okay, Mike, we're just coming up the road looking slowly, slowly. Go ahead, Mike. Yeah, okay. Charlie, you want to take it? Yeah, the helicopter pilot thinks he saw it, but if you can just keep following to see where that calf's gone, over. Watch your footprints.
Norman, we've found baby rhino. Repeat, found baby rhino. We're closing in for the dark. Do you read? Over.
Confirm you found the rhino.
Got to get back in.
This is a young calf. It's fully less than 5 months old. That's why we couldn't find it in the bush.
God, this thing's young, man. This would have been buzzed by lions. Quick, quick, quick.
Alistair, good flying then. I was getting dizzy. We were going around in circles.
Good to get down on this little bugger.
Yeah, warthog.
That's most disgusting. No, I didn't even rise to that.
Mark, we just couldn't get down on it. It's so small, man.
Yes. Okay.
That horn probably weighs 200 grams. I mean, that's still a lot of money if you talk about $2,000 per kilogram.
Poachers will kill for this horn.
I wonder if the cow will take him.
Oh, yeah. If it doesn't, then it's going to have to be fostered. But the mother should do. Norman, we should all go back because we need to introduce it to the mum. Okay. And then we can come out again.
Okay, let's head back. Chop, eh? Please. Okay, let's get going now. Let's get this animal back because these calves, they don't control their body temperatures very well.
You want to take it straight through next to the bomo, or you want to put it in here?
This aged calf, if the poachers kill the mum, they'll shoot the calf as well, and they'll take that. They don't have any feelings towards these animals whatsoever. It's just a job to kill it and get the horn. There have been instances where poachers have killed a mother and not taken the calf, and the calf has stayed next to the mum until it's died, you know. Now, our big problem is reintroducing it. We've been touching her and stuff like that, but she's a little bit tranquilized from long-acting tranquilizers, so hopefully she'll be accepted. It's relying probably on mother's milk completely. It probably needs a feed. She's been away from mum overnight. We've also been handling, so there's human smells, and sometimes they'll reject the calf. When we introduce them, if she does start throwing the calf around, then we've got to be very careful. The thing that we do to try and minimize any damage is tipping the horns. As you can see, the horns are flat, so that if the mum does knock the baby, she's not going to spike it with a sharp horn.
Indeed.
Okay, enough of that now. Let's just skip it. Okay, enough. But we were lucky in this case. She really, I mean, they just butted heads once, I think, and then they were fine.
Oh, it feels good, man. It feels good.
Now, wasn't that good?
In national parks, wilderness areas, game ranches, all rhinos, both black and white, are going under the chainsaw.
Dehorning was a crisis management strategy that we developed in order to try and reduce the risk of our rhino populations from being poached.
The horn that evolved for the rhino's defense is now being cut off to save it, but not without international criticism.
I don't think it's naming this stuff grows back.
This guy, we're going to wake up with an antidote, and he's going to stand up and he's going to wander off. At least he's going to be alive. If we don't do it, we're not going to see this animal in the next decade. Again in the bush.
We're beyond the point now of trying to argue that we can control the trade. I mean, the recent reports Taiwan put out of 13,000 traditional medicine shops, 10,000 of them are carrying rhino horn.
It is an illegal commodity at the moment that people want and people have been using for 2,000 years. And that's not going to change.
Asian pharmacists prescribe horn from all of the world's five rhino species to treat many ailments, especially fever, but also menstrual problems and even madness. Rhino horn does, in fact, reduce fever, but not as effectively as aspirin. Zimbabwe's white rhinos are also being dehorned to deter poachers. The world cannot afford to lose the rhino, but Zimbabwe cannot afford the enormous cost of protecting them.
That's about 5 kgs of horn there. That's about $10,000 on the illegal market. That would pay for part of this, probably half of this operation.
The cost of dehorning each rhino is thousands of dollars. But what does the loss of a horn mean to a rhino? Janet Racklow, a conservation biologist from the United States, is in Zimbabwe to find out how dehorning affects rhinos.
It's probably not a pleasant experience, but in the long run, it doesn't hurt the animal, and you're not permanently disfiguring the animal because the horn does regrow.
Janet is studying both African rhinos, black and white, and working with the dehorning team.
Rhinos differ a lot. They're as different as polar bears and grizzly bears. Their bodies are different, their behavior is very different. Black rhino, much more aggressive. This animal is number 49. She's a cow we dehorned last year. We've given her the name Izazela, which in Ndebele means suspicious or curious, and we've been chased in the past by her, and you can see she's really going to put up a fight and not go down easily.
Janet?
Yes?
Come and get measurements while she's standing here, please.
Okay.
The white rhino is a completely different species from the black. It's the same color, but almost twice the size. White is a misnomer from the Afrikaans word wide, as it has a wide mouth for eating grass.
Just on a limited number of animals, one of the things we've done is to re-immobilize animals and look at horn regrowth. And on a few animals, it appears as though it's something like 8 centimeters per year for the front horn and something 3, 3.5 for the back horn.
Okay, front circumference is 67.
Okay. There's been some abnormality in horn regrowth, but most of the horns have regrown fine. Some of that abnormality may be related to cutting too low initially, and it's something we're learning as we go along. We've seen lions harass cows, but never make contact with the cows or the calves. I mean, they still go through the same head movements, sort of a horn thrust, and when they interact with each other, they also go through the same behavioral movements that you would expect if they had a horn. And so probably a really important aspect of making this whole program work as far as deterring poaching is getting the word out that, hey, the animals in here don't have horns, it's not worth it to even enter the park.
Now poachers are killing dehorned rhinos for even more sinister reasons. They're trying to eliminate the species completely to inflate the price of remaining horn.
Zulu, 0 Zulu, 368.
Too close to talk.
In the field, you work with the scouts, with the black scouts here. They're exceptional trackers. They have an exceptional knowledge of the bush. And the surprising thing is, if you sit down with them and talk to them about Chipambiri, which is the black rhino, they have a very strong feeling about it. They are very against the poachers. They don't have any qualms at shooting them.
Killed three poachers. They picked up spoor at one of the pans just near main camp. Was it yesterday? Yesterday, Jackson?
Yes, yesterday.
Yesterday. And they've been on the spoor since then. And this morning, while we were working trying to find rhino to dehorn, they found the spoor was very, very fresh. And they've just had a contact, and they've killed three poachers.
Poaching is not the only setback for the capture team. The small male calf is rapidly losing condition.
The fact that it had been away from its mother for about 24 hours meant that it was probably a little dehydrated and it might very well have fed on leaves and browse. But then it developed gut pains and it was treated. It finally died, and what had happened is the guts had twisted.
The loss of the calf is a blow to the capture team. Now they are more determined than ever to get every last rhino before the poachers. As weeks go by, the number of rhinos captured builds up. Number 15 is brought in. And now it's thought only one rhino, a female, remains in the entire Chetty wilderness.
And I think that she's been harassed as well because we've been trying to catch her. Quite likely that she might even be shot at by the poachers. They don't do well with disturbance. She's become very clever at avoiding people. I mean, that's sad.
One of the problems here is that it's this difficult country to track because of the rocks and the type of sand as well. But also with the wind, if the animal's disturbed, they'll keep the wind up their backs and constantly change. So they constantly smell you and they just move ahead and you can chase it for hours without success.
The trackers find the spoor of the cow, but also poachers' footprints hot on her trail.
Now they're following one rhino for 2-3 weeks. And I mean, they follow that from dawn to dusk. And that rhino just runs and runs and runs. And sometimes it's got to sleep. It's got to sleep, and they'll catch it then and they'll kill it.
The rhino's hearing is extremely good, extremely sensitive. Eyesight's not so good, but their smell is very acute as well.
5 Alpha, 3-6 left. Yeah, Tuckers, we need to get some ropes. We're going to have to walk this animal out of this gully. 2 ropes for the back leg and 1 rope for the head.
Jetty's last rhino has fallen in country where no vehicle can follow.
Well, you guys wanted a shitty bit of country for rhino, and you've got it right on the nose. What a circus. Oh. Okay, you get ready now, huh? Tuckers, are you right-handed or left-handed?
I am right-handed.
You come on the right side here, I'll go on the left side.
The precise dose of reversal drug is critical, just enough for her to walk. To get the semi-drugged animal to her feet, Mike uses a trick learnt from another bush vet.
Right, right up. Right,
stop.
Yeah, take this.
These scouts who spend all the time in the bush, who've been chased up trees by rhinos, they would be tremendously sad, I think, to see the black rhino go.
All right, where's the sled? We got it. Okay, let's get the sled here before we pull over.
Okay.
The black rhino is a wilderness species. It lives in Chetty Safari area here, or has for hundreds and hundreds of years, and for it not to be here. I mean, how do you measure that? You can't.
One, two, three. Okay,
okay.
There's a real heartfelt side to the black scout who works with black rhino. They write songs about the rhino, and they sing them, you know, around the campfire.
Mumbe mbiri ne majongi mashanu sevenza namichauya mumbe mbiri ne majongi mashanu sevenza namichauya sevenza namichauya sevenza.
I feel very sad. I think that for future generations to go and see the black rhino in a zoo or see a picture of it in a picture book, that's a reflection of our inability to handle our environment and our resources.
Thank you.
Of the 16 Chetty rhinos captured, 9 are declared disease-free and are bound for Australia. The others will be sent to private wildlife conservancies within Zimbabwe.
They're being hammered out of existence here in Zimbabwe. I mean, there's so few rhino left on the ground that they just won't breed. So the best thing is get them into farms and then get a bank outside of Africa.
We've seen horns come through crates very quickly. Crates for Australia have got very thick hardwood. Yeah, they can smash a plank out of those crates very quickly.
We give them a tiny bit of the same drug that we use to knock them down with in the bush, just to stop them from fighting the crate when we walk them in. And this guy is perfectly sedated. The animal's just resting very quietly in the crate. It's not head pushing and struggling, so it's really nice, and it'll travel well.
7 females and 2 males will make up the Australian breeding herd.
Someone just hit on the backside.
The rhinos are given names to suit their personalities. This cow was called Chitundu Maseri Maseri, which means rocket in the Shona language, because of her fiery behavior.
Okay, Donza!
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 That is Champupuri. In English name we call it wheel wound. So this rhino gives that name because he's always running around the pen.
Just let him go all the way. You guys are half asleep, man. And let's get a reversal together for it, Dave.
Goza!
Hang on.
Go!
I don't see them being back here in the next 20, 30 years. There'll always be a trade, I feel. And I don't see it being controlled enough to be able to allow a wild rhino back in, unless we get enough rhino bred up in captivity, dehorned and brought back in here. So let's get them out, get ourselves breathing space, and then at a later date, bring rhino back in by all means. I mean, it would be a real pleasure to hear those huffing, puffing things that are running around in the bush. It won't be Chetty, and it won't be Africa, I think, without rhino.
Are airlifted in a Russian Aleutian, a military aircraft unleashed of its Cold War duties. Captain and co-pilot are ex-MiG fighter pilots who now specialize in flying unusual cargo all round the world. After an 8-hour flight, the rhinos reach Cocos Keeling, a cluster of coral islands in the heart of the Indian Ocean.
Yeah.
rhinos will spend 60 days in quarantine on these remote tropical islands before continuing onto the Australian mainland. Isolated by oceans, Australia's animals are relatively disease-free, and all exotic imports must pass rigorous disease testing. Zookeeper Phil Whalen, who will look after the rhinos in Australia, travels with them so they get to know him. He grows very fond of his animals and is concerned when Tamana, the big old male, refuses to eat. A blood test reveals a condition known as hemolytic anemia.
And he ended up passing away on the 42nd day, I think it was, of the quarantine, which was quite a sad day for everyone, I think, involved in the project. I was actually there when he died. It was very, very sad.
Papa X-ray Hotel 146, ready for departure from Caucasus, destination.
The quarantine period complete, the remaining eight animals depart for their long journey from Caucasus to Australia's capital, Canberra. This is the first time in 50 years that wild African animals have been brought to the shores of Australia. Champapuri, the young bull, is restless. It will be midnight before they reach Canberra. The rhinos are welcomed as long-awaited guests of honour. Arrive with the sunrise at Western Plains Zoo, an open range zoo at Dubbo, 400 kilometres west of Sydney. Here, the climate is very similar to their home in Zimbabwe. The rhinos will be among strangers, but also some neighbours familiar to them. First time the rhinos have been out of a compound or crate since they were taken from the African bush 6 months ago. The first out is Chitundu Maseri Maseri. Champapuri, the whirlwind, is next out. He's only a young bull, yet his power and rage is deadly. During the night, Champapuri succumbs to serious head injuries, and by morning, the last of the male rhinos is dead.
I was devastated, I think, along with every other staff member involved in the project. It came as quite a shock to us that the animal behaved in such a way, and then to have him run into the fence the way he did. I got the news that night that he died, and it was just one hell of a shock. However, that's the price we've got to pay to save these animals from extinction.
After this major setback, the plan now is to bring in captive bred rhino bulls from international zoos. The hope is that this herd will eventually produce 40 young that can be returned to Africa to safe areas in Zimbabwe.
There are 299 black rhino out there, and a lot of their friends have been lost over the last decade, and I think that we can't possibly give up on those last few. We're determined to make the fact that rhinos went to Australia, the fact that rhinos went to America, worthwhile, with the support, the understanding from people who don't live in Africa. The white rhino, for example, in the 60s, recovered from less than 200 into now numbers of about 5,800. So I think we could do it with a black rhino, and we're trying.
Colder climbs next Friday at 8 when Mountain Survivors chronicles winter life for inhabitants of the Alps.